coming up on Need to Know Rochester. A look at the circles of life as one local trailblazer works to continue making her mark on Rochester. A conversation with the first Black City Council president of Rochester on the details of her new memoir. Also on the show, we learn about an upstate New York startup company that aims to help improve the economy of Haiti through cosmetics. And a local drama club teaches kids with intellectual disabilities about teamwork and much more. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know Rochester.
Rochester's news magazine since 1997. This is Need to Know Rochester.
Hello, I'm Helene B. and Duty Hofer. Thank you for joining me for this edition of Need to Know Rochester. My journey from who I was to who I am supposed to be. That's how former Rochester City Council member Ruth Scott describes her journey in life in her new memoir called The Circles God Draws. She seems to leave no stone unturned as she reflects on the life she's lived as an educator, community leader, elected politician, friend, wife, and mother, among other titles. Her story also includes experiences with racial and gender discrimination, political victory and loss, and even poetry. Joining me now to talk more about her memoirs and the chapters of her story that have yet to unfold is Ruth Scott. And Ruth, it's great to have you here with me.
Thank you, Helen. It's great to be here.
So some memoirs, they're tell-alls, right? And they reveal experiences, issues, and personal reflections. And you've said in your memoir, The Circle God Draws, as I read, my journey from who I was to who I am supposed to be. Mm-hmm. Can you just explain that a bit to me? And why the decision to write a memoir?
Well, first, the decision to write a memoir. I have been wanting to write for years and years and years, but just didn't have the time, it seemed. And a lot of people, after I became very visible in the Rochester community, thought I should write a memoir. And they ask and ask and ask. And finally, I had a little accident a few years ago where a city garbage truck ran into a car I was standing behind and threw me across the driveway. And so I had some time to recover. And it was during that time that I really became more interested in writing the memoir. And Ruth Napperstack, who is my editor and publisher, came to me and said, it's time to write your memoir, and I'm going to help you. Little did I know what she meant, is she was going to hold me accountable. So anyway, that's how I started to write. This journey thing is, I've always looked at life as a journey between two eternities, you know, the eternity we came from and the eternity that we move towards. And somehow, during the process of moving from one place to another, it seemed to me we were always searching. Who are we? What are we supposed to do? What are we supposed to be? And I think a lot of people get sort of stopped in the journey, either because of the boxes people put them in or because their own insecurities about who they are. And I have been blessed to have parents and other people around me who said, you know, just keep being who you are. Just keep being who you are. And I've been able to do that with great success.
And tell me, how does that wrap in with the title, The Circles God Draws? How would you explain that, and how does it connect with the lives of others?
Well, I think in addition to the fact that I believe in this idea of our searching, there are certain influences that help us to develop that search. Family, friends, where we were born, where we grew up. But in addition to that, I think there's a divine piece in that that is just beyond our description and perhaps beyond our imagination. And it's like there are spiritual forces in our lives if we want to tap into them, and those forces bring us into certain circles that we never otherwise would be involved with.
One thing that really stood out to me was your father's love of poetry. And then before we started taping, I said we both love the poem Invictus by William Ernest Henley. And you actually began your memoir with a poem of your own that you wrote called The Inheritance of Our Mother's Shackles and Power. And you wrote at the end of the poem, we were fashioned by a creator who makes butterfly wings, and that is why the Mona Lisa smiles, and this is the connection between caged birds and phenomenal women.
Yes.
And definitely that last sentence there, a reference to the great Maya Angelou.
Absolutely.
And we learned this week of her death, and it's a great loss that we all share. And you actually met her for the first time at the swearing-in of President Jimmy Carter. And I wanted to know, how does her influence, in essence, encompass really the message of your memoir?
Well, you know, she starts out, one of the early books that she wrote was I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. And she lived a life that was fraught with challenges and difficulties in growing up and some tragic things that happened to her. But her life was beyond those things. And I think that really is a kind of inspiration that every child and every person needs and can, that will help them to grow. And she, you know, meeting her was a part of the circles that God drew for me. So it's kind of like, you know, our lives are bound in some way that we can't quite explain. And of course, I feel very saddened by her death. It's like a light in the heavens dimmed. It didn't go out, but it dimmed when I realized that she was no longer with us on earth. But I believe she is with us still.
In your book, you share some experiences as an educator, and you go into quite some depth explaining how you try to find a job in your home state of Michigan as a high school teacher, and how difficult that was for an African American woman to do. And you ended up teaching at a junior high, started off in Cleveland, Ohio, and you said in your book that some of your African American students, it was difficult to buy into your optimism about having a successful future for their lives, and you said they internalized the lack of success they saw in the lives of their parents and other relatives. And they shared stories with you of relatives who got their college degree and yet they were working at the post office, and thus they didn't understand why the need to pursue college if that was the type of job that they would end up with. And I wanted to ask you, you know, what are the similarities and differences between the mindset back then, we're talking late 50s, early 60s, and today?
Among youth particularly, yes. I think there is still perhaps some feeling among youth who are labeled as unsuccessful, as poor. You know, we have these titles that we give to people. And therefore, you know, they can't possibly learn. Their experiences in their home are not good experiences. Their experiences in their schools are bad experiences. And yet, there are young people who do succeed. I mean, we've proven that by the Black Scholars Group that the Urban League addresses. Mm-hmm. And if young people can just understand that there's something inside of them, more than anybody might believe or know about, that can reach out and connect to those things that will give them success, perhaps they will be inspired to go on and to strive. I often wonder what happened to some of those students that I taught, you know, because some of them were so discouraged and so, oh, you know, that's just not possible for me. Well, what you see can be possible, but you have to see it internally. And so people have to develop that ability to help them do that.
Well, you transitioned into the local political life, and you were sworn in as a Rochester City Council member in 77. You became the first African-American president of the council. And I wanted to know why the decision, being an educator for so long, you moved to Rochester with your husband, Bill, after the 64 riots, and you said that you felt this urgency to get involved in local political activities. Why the transition into local politics?
Well, the transition, I had not intended to make my career as a political person. I just wanted to be involved. Part of the challenge in my life has been able to convince people that there's a kind of democratic lifeline. That is, if we live in a democracy, if we don't plug into the power, which means that you are a voter, you are an intelligent voter because you read about your candidates, and you work on political campaigns because that gives you insight that otherwise you would not have, that you really are lacking something that's very important if our democracy is going to survive into the next century. It's really, really difficult to have a democracy where people don't participate, and yet we do. And so I knew that I had to be a participator. And my father was very, you know, gung-ho about the fact that you needed to participate. And there's so many people that have died, given their lives on the line in order to make sure we had a right to vote. And so everybody said, well, you know, after the Voting Rights Act and things like that, we don't need to worry about that anymore. But we do need to worry about it because there are states that are trying to roll it back. And because whether they roll it back or not, there are people who never go to the polls. They think, oh, that doesn't matter, it won't make a difference. It does, it really does.
Well, you also cover your run for mayor and many other things in the book that I love to touch upon, but I want to close with this reference to grit. And the word grit is something that I think we hear so much about now in terms of kids and the connection to education. And you mentioned, you talked about how your mother had such grit and the determination to be there for her family. And I wanted to ask you, how has grit served you on your journey? I know we've got to wrap, but, and also how do you think it will continue to serve you in those chapters of your book that have yet to be told?
Well, I think that grit is something that's sort of an internal fortitude, and you build it over time by what you read, by what you do, by what you think, and how you expand your mind. And it helps you to look at situations as challenges instead of as defeats. You don't look at something and say, oh, I can't go past that line, because you believe that you can go anywhere you want to be through the grace of God and through your own strength.
Ruth Scott, it's a pleasure talking with you. And her book is available, her memoir, The Circle Scott Draws, is on bookshelves right now. You can also get your copy online at Amazon.com. October 18th, Finger Lakes Community College in Canandaigua, a book review. Ruth will be leading that discussion. Be sure to tune in. All right, so we're going to transition now to startup companies. Now, many new startup companies end up running their new businesses out of their homes. And that's the case with this next story from the Innovation Trail. Stéphane Jean-Baptiste and Yves Carr Monperousse live and work in Ithaca, New York. But their sustaining business model relies heavily on the relationship with the land and people of Haiti. As you'll see, they're aiming to be successful and socially responsible entrepreneurs and help in the rebuilding of the island nation devastated by the 2010 earthquake.
A few years ago, I went to the hairdresser with my huge afro and I wanted to straighten my hair. And the woman was like, okay, I'm gonna need to put lots of heat in your hair. I said, all right, she's the professional, sure, go ahead. So she straightens my hair, my hair looks awesome.
But 2 days later, my hair started to fall out when I was washing it. And as a good millennial, after crying, I went online to try to find a remedy.
And I was like, oh, how come I didn't think about this before? L'huile mascoutie, which is what we call it in Haiti, or Haitian black castor oil. And I said, okay, this is easy. I live in Philadelphia. I'm just going to go to the store and I'm going to find it. Couldn't find it in the stores anywhere. So I called my mom and I said, funny enough, what if I bought like castor oil from Haiti? Because I said, I know you have a stash somewhere that you could send me some. And she said, you know what, that's actually not a bad idea. That's how we began on this journey of how to bring castor oil to the States. This is the warehouse. Pretty simple. Stéphane actually, domain. His domain, he put it together.
Oh. Uh-huh. 55 gallons of castor oil.
Mm-hmm. He just goes online and he can see exactly, you know, where the orders are coming from.
In Haitian culture, the oil is used for a number of different reasons, not only cosmetics, but medicinal. So if you have a child that's sick, particularly those who are poor, you use Haitian black castor oil. That's what we use as our Vicks vapor rub. So it's used for everything.
Yves Carr being the forward thinking of the two of us, you know.
That's why I'm with him.
You know, identify, you know, as we're putting the business plan together, you know, starting a business in Haiti, you know, folks often say, okay, why are you sourcing from there? You know, at our hearts of hearts, we knew we always wanted to do something in Haiti, but at the end of the day, it's still a business and you still have to mitigate certain risks. And, you know, we thought, let's also look into either renting or buying property down there so that we can actually develop our own backup source.
And that's where, you know, we were able to employ the 70 folks, mm-hmm. because we have some folks there who are farming and planting the castor bean, and then we also have women who are producing the oil.
Haiti's known historically as the Pearl of the Antilles. Historically, this is where, you know, the French made billions, you know, off of sugar and cotton, and, you know, Haiti's known for its cocoa, for its coffee. And so when you think about socioeconomic impact, you have to think about the environment and you have to think about the agriculture.
once the earthquake happened, we had actually put the business on hold to help with relief efforts. But my mom said, you know, once the cameras are gone and there's no one there paying attention to Haiti, what is aid going to do? This is the time for you to really focus on the business, because that's what's going to be sustainable change for people in Haiti.
When research said that the castor plant is one that actually adds nutrients into the soil, we're like, yes, even better, because, you know, we know that not only will it help create jobs, but it's something that's going to go back into the environment and sort of help re-nourish a lot of the lost land.
Côté masquette a planté, c'est un terre béni. Son premier bagage est son bénédiction. Depuis que masquette vous pense à l'outil son terre, terre a venu reprendre bénédiction pour elle ou planter sept nèvres. Premier bagage, deuxième bagage, lui relâche terre. C'est comme d'adou si terre a été dû. Masquitia li vin remonter terre comme dans tout micro-organisme qui dans terre qui était caché tout vin a développé et puis terre vin une nouvelle vie. Li vin produit l'autre manière avec beaucoup de.
You have a lot of folks cutting down trees because that's how they make money.
Right.
So, if they have other jobs and other means to take care of themselves, that won't be the path that they take. Secondly, now we're paying farmers above market rate to actually plant the seeds. So they make more money planting and selling us the seeds than they would if they were cutting down the trees. Mm-hmm. So I'm in the International Development Program at Cornell, the focus on agriculture, and my classes have been tropical crop science, farm management. I'm like, there are courses around this stuff? This is awesome. Because I do want to make sure that when I'm working with the farmers, right, that, you know, there's an understanding and I understand the things that they're thinking about. Coming from New York, Philadelphia, which we love, there's this just constant go, go, go. And one of the things that we love about being in upstate New York is that even though we're still in the go, go, go mode, when we come home, it is relaxing, even though home is also where we work, which is interesting.
But, you know, it does add to the stress a little bit to say, okay, all right, let's get the shipment in, you know, but I got to put dinner on the table.
We have to bring products over to Cornell.
For what?
For the speaking engagement I have
for Saturday?
Mm-hmm.
We have to do it beforehand?
Well, it's either we do it today or we do it tomorrow at 9 a.m., but I know we were supposed to go to do that.
So we feel very supported here in Ithaca, and we're around like-minded folks in the upstate region who care about what's happening globally, as we do feel we want to be global citizens.
Come on,
there are so many cultural connections all over the world. So to bring that under one umbrella of a company is exciting.
Surtout ça l'ouverture. Peuple français, renseigne-toi donc.
To learn more about Kreyol Essence and its work in New York and Haiti, check out the website kreyolessence.com. We transition now to Dr. Seuss, or rather, Seussical the Musical. That's the name of the sold-out show by the Norman Howard School Drama Club. The performances were a huge hit this spring in Rochester, but perhaps even more successful is the core of the Drama Club's mission and how it works to help students build upon life skills. Need to Know Rochester's Carlette Claire is at the desk right now to share more.
Thank you, Helen. I'm joined by founder and artistic director of the Main Street Players Theater Company, Terry Fike. Terry is also the artistic director for the Norman Howard School Drama Club. Also joining us is Kim Kleps, administrative director for the Drama Club at the Norman Howard School. It's great to have you both here with us today.
Thank you for having us.
You're welcome. So, Seussical the Musical, Kilroy was here, a couple of the theatrical performances that was put on by the Norman Howard School Drama Club. So the Norman Howard School, the mission behind it is to be able to provide one-on-one attention to students who have special needs, learning needs, correct? Such as autism or speech and language impairments. So the Drama Club kicked off in 2012 mm-hmm. by two students from the school, one of whom is Kim's son.
Yes.
So Kim, can you just start off by telling us how the Drama Club began?
Well, very quickly, it all began when he met his friend Ian in ninth grade, and they started singing together, and we started to go and watch him, Ian, perform at Terry's Community Theater Group, and eventually they started to sing together, and Ian convinced Nick, why don't you go ahead and try one of the plays? And so they did. And so once that happened, I approached the co-head of the school and said, what would it take to get a drama club started here at the school? And she said it would take a parent driving it. So I immediately dove in and talked with Terry and said, how would you like to start a partnership and really make a difference at the school? So that was the beginning of that. And in 2012, we started with the first performance. So.
Part of the school's goal is to maximize student learning as well as social growth. And Kim, we were talking a little bit before, hand, and you said the drama club brings the students out. It builds confidence, it helps them with social aptitude, and they just develop personally. Can you just describe to us what that transformation looks like in terms of your son, Nick?
Sure. When you think about where they start in a school like that, they're there with being individuals, you know, and trying to make those connections, which they do a great job at the school in different classes having that happen. When you find an opportunity where they can find their quote thing and they can connect, this is where it happened, and it really happened on stage. It allows them, through Terry's direction, to really become part of a team. And so what happened for Nick personally was he just started becoming more confident, his self-esteem grew, his skills grew, he started to really see that I can really do this. And before he knew it, he was really taking a lot of the direction that Terry gave to him and implementing it and applying it right away. And so for him, it's really made a huge difference in his confidence level and his self-esteem, which carries then through the other parts of his day and into the classroom. So performance does change in school as well. So it's been a great opportunity.
What was he like a little bit before he got on stage?
I think what happens is that the children, at least for Nick, you know, he was not necessarily as self-aware of the impact of his conversations with students. And through theater, it allows them to become self-aware of where they are as part of a group. And I think for kids like Nick, when they have that disconnect to not know what the other person's thinking or feeling, when they have to do it through the opportunity of a script, that gives them that great opportunity. And then through that, he learns. And it's funny because sometimes I'll say, what would you do if you were on stage? You know, if a situation is troubling him. And so it is really through that process that it gives them that opportunity. So,
Terry, tell us how you assist that change as the drama club instructor.
Probably the main thing I do is I see child at face value at that moment. I don't have preconceived identities about them when they come into the theater program. I just audition them like I would any other program, and then I believe, I encourage them to keep pursuing it, and I believe in them. And I think it actually helps me not to know a lot about their backgrounds, because I believe everybody has that ability to, whatever level they come in at, if it's here, that they can grow. So my goal is just to, whatever skills they come in, to take them to the next level, and just to keep encouraging them. I tend to do it through positive feedback and also through lots of sitting down and talking with the kids, what's working and what's not working and how we can grow. I try to not initially address a child individually about a correction, because I don't want to discourage them as they're beginning this new process. And we try to make it a very safe environment so they can try new things and be successful. And then as we get to know each other better, we can get very specific ways to help them grow.
What are some challenges that you may come across or encounter along the way when doing this?
Well, some children have different abilities and different needs. And at times, somebody might have a lot of anxiety about going on stage or even about practicing in front of their peers. Another child may have a reading area where they're struggling a bit with the words. So what we do is we just continue, whatever that means for that group, to make it safe. For a child that might have anxiety, we won't stop and address it, like make a big deal about it. We'll say, I understand you're feeling uncomfortable now. You can go take a 5-minute break and come back, and maybe one of our staff will go walk with them, or I'll walk with them, or Kim will go for a little walk. And we just then go on. We don't make it like that's the end all. It's just part of the process. And the same with, if there's a reading skill, then we will say the lines first. They'll say them back to us. If it's a writing skill, we just work with what the skills that they have. And again, the opportunity is to grow. And what I find is their peers actually jump in that process. It's really encouraging to see that they become supportive to each other. So it's not, it becomes not just me. As long as I transfer my philosophy to them, then they begin to do it with each other. And that's probably one of the most rewarding things, that I see friends making teamwork and support to each other that maybe walking down the hallway they wouldn't have done. But in this environment, because we've established a safe zone, they make that choice too.
Right now, I want to go and take a look at a clip of the Norman Howard School students as they perform Seussical the Musical, which features characters from 15 Dr. Seuss books.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Let's take a look.
Okay.
We're on the brink of war. They say we're going to war, and I can say for you. Well, here on you, well, you can get to the goodbye.
Onward traveled and onward flew. We know there was trouble.
Okay, so we saw a little bit of the students performing at the Norman Howard School. Just really briefly, what's coming up next for the drama club? Any means of expanding?
Well, we've actually been talking with the school because of the benefits of what they've seen in the students. Terry's probably most likely going to be teaching at the school next year in the school year for the middle schoolers, and then another whole production in the fall and spring,
which we'll announce next week, I believe.
Okay, so. Great. Yeah. Thank you so much, Kim Kleps and Terry Fike of the Norman Howard School Drama Club. Thank you for being here with me today. This segment was part of WXXI's Move to Include in partnership with the Golisano Foundation, working with the community to lead change toward the inclusion of people with intellectual and physical disabilities. Discover how you can make a difference at movetoinclude.org. Helen? Thank you, Carlette. And that's it for this edition of Need to Know Rochester. I'm Helen Biandudi Hofer. As always, thank you for joining us on Thursday nights and throughout the weekend. And thank you for supporting news and public affairs programming on WXXI. I'll see you next week.